96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
And I'm here on Guardian Radio 96.9, fresh news, smart talk all day. And this morning we have a cadre of hosts with us. We're going to get right into our conversation. They're going to be contributors. And we're speaking about children on the spectrum. There are a lot of misconceptions. There are a great many of things that we absolutely do not know as it relates to children being on the spectrum. And this morning we have with us persons that are here to speak with us. Now, it's going to be a very, very tightly packed show. So I have questions that have already been sent into my inbox. And so with that, we're going to dive directly into what it means to be on the spectrum, who is on the spectrum, how is it identified. And this morning, let me introduce my contributors. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you for having us. My name is Donnell Major Fox. I am the founder and president of Families on the Spectrum Bahamas. And we are an autism organization advocating for fair and opportunities for our children right here in the Bahamas.
Go ahead, Mr. Miller.
You tip them off.
I did. Too fast.
Good morning, Bahamas. I'm Keith Miller. I'm Vice President of Family on the Spectrum, Bahamas. It's a pleasure to be here to try to inform the public of what parents go through who have children on the spectrum. It's much more intense and varied than what people, I think, they understand. So we're going to try to clear up some misconceptions this morning for you.
And hi, I'm Dr. Swan Miller, also a member of Families on the Spectrum of Bahamas, physician and mother.
So now I want to talk to you about something. How did you decide that you wanted to start this group? But before we even get into starting of the organization, how did you identify that your child was on the spectrum?
Well, around the time that he would have turned two, my eldest sister, she started to notice that there were some developmental delays. He was not speaking, and he was, you know, behaving in certain ways that was not typical of a typically developing child. And so I started to do my own research, and I ended up picking up on, you know, some more things that he was displaying and exhibiting as a child. And at that point, I realized that we had to seek out an evaluation to, you know, confirm what was speculated in the beginning.
So there were cognitive and behavioral differences that you definitely recognized.
Right.
But other than that, he would seem as if though he was at the same pace as everybody else.
Right.
So what urged you to say, I needed to get help for my son? Is it the inadequacies that are happening here in New Providence that urged you to say, listen, I have to get my son the best possible assistance? Because aren't you a teacher by profession?
I am a teacher by profession. Okay. What really pushed me to get that evaluation done was there was an instance where he was in the room and he was playing with his blocks. And I called him. And he did not turn, he did not answer, he did not flinch. And I just remember banging on the door and screaming his name and the same thing, same response. He did not turn, he did not flinch. And so I, you know, someone suggested that we have him tested for a hearing problem, which we did, and it came back that his hearing was fine. And at that point, it, you know, after doing my research, I realized that something else needed to happen. And that's when we sought out an evaluation for him.
Okay, so when it, do you know if there are any other mothers, parents in this particular situation that you had to reach out to say, listen, I think that my son or my child is on the spectrum. How do I identify? What do I do? Was there anywhere for you to seek some sort of solvents for yourself?
Initially, I was introduced to Dwayne and Kim Gibson. They were parents. They are parents of a child on the spectrum. And I was introduced to them. And they would have told me all of the struggles that they would have had to endure with getting their son the help that he needed and, you know, how that affected their family greatly. Other than that, there were no other families that I knew of directly. And so I was left to kind of fend for myself, do my own research, try to connect with persons who I know would have left the country to get help for their kids.
Now, speak to me about leaving the country, because I am aware of who you are. And you and I had many conversations,
right,
because I know your sister and we're related in some sort of form or fashion.
Yes.
By marriage. Now, you left. You literally left New Providence because you could not get the assistance and the progression that you needed for your child. Was it that detrimental that you had to leave?
Yes, it was. It was. It was difficult being able to find a school that would provide more than academic instruction. There were no options for therapies within the school system, that public or private. Those were things that you had to seek outside of the school. So I realized, and even seeking it outside of the school, it was costly. It was scarce. And so I realized that if I didn't do something drastic, I would lose my child, mm-hmm, and eventually lose myself. Because as a parent, this disorder, it affects you to the very core of your soul. To see your child suffering, unable to communicate, unable to express themselves in the way that they need to, among other things. So I got involved and I did some research and I found that New Jersey was the top state for autism services in the world, basically. And with family support, family and friends support, I was able to make that move. And within months of us being there, I saw a tremendous improvement in our son.
Okay. Mr. Miller and Dr. Miller, what brings you here today? Tell us your situation.
So twofold. Like, we joined up with Donnell with regards to autism advocacy and the need for treatment and better services in the Bahamas.
We, too, also have, we have two children that are on the spectrum, a daughter and a son. And not only that, I see it at least once or twice a week. I work in the pediatric field. I'm a pediatric doctor, and both public and private sector, we see a lot of it, too. And as a physician, you want to be able to help people. You want to be able to help the children. You're a child advocate. And just recognizing that there were a lot of kids that were going undiagnosed, and the ones that you did come across and you realized that, hey, that this is a problem, and then not being able to actually direct them to the treatment that they need, the intervention that they need in a timely manner, because things are, basically we have very limited resources here. The resources that we do have, I'm grateful for it. In the public sector, we do have a few schools, very few schools, that would allow the children to have a special education class, but the support they need in terms of applied behavioral analysis, because it's a communication and a behavioral issue, speech therapy, occupational therapy, it's very, very limited. So we know the struggles that we had to go through with our two children, and the struggles that we're still going through. And it's due to limited resources, finances, being able to push and advocate for there to be more services, but just not getting the support that you need. So when Donnell came and, you know, we met actually at an institution where both of our kids were at, and that was extremely expensive at the time.
Right.
So that's how we got talking and saying, you know, something, we need to try to do more. We need to get together and see if we can do more, not just for our kids, but the other families that we saw, because we understood the struggle. It was no longer, okay, I understand, we empathize, we knew what they were going through, and then especially people who had much less resources than we did. Right. That's the big thing. So, like, even in the public sector now, me seeing the parents coming to me and saying what they're going through, and I know what they're going through. So it I'm very passionate about it. Passionate about seeing a change in the Bahamas, because we do. It's something that we put a Band-Aid on, and it's a big festering wound, and the Band-Aid just would not do.
You speak, Dr. Miller, about what it does for you, and Donella spoke about what it does for her to see her child not being able to communicate. So I'm thinking in some instances that it may be nonverbal. Mm-hmm. But you as the adult, you know how hard this real world is out here. And at some point in time, you have to think in terms of resources and what's going to happen with your children.
Exactly.
Is there anywhere for you to go as adults? Is there an outreach for you to say, listen, I've dealt with this all weekend. And of course, being a parent is a 24/7 rule. Mm-hmm. But is there somewhere for you to go to get solace? Is there someplace that you go to speak to your troubles and say, listen, I need a break. I'm at my wit's end? Because you speak about having the Band-Aid and the placebo effect of it all. But what happens for you, because you are the champion of this particular individual, this child, what happens when you get frustrated? Are there clues? Are there things that you can do to help you? What about you?
Not really. I mean, in regards to finding your own personal resources in terms of counselors, let's not forget that there is an organization as well, too, and Reach does provide support groups as well, and we're grateful to them for that as well. And then the group itself, you know, you back and forth and you're able to say, you know, this I'm going through and all of that. But no, other than that, it's very, very limited.
It's extremely limited.
Very
so tell
limited.
Me something. How do you, Dr. Miller, as a professional, mm-hmm. how do you identify that this children is on the spectrum? I know the other week, we had to wear, everyone was asking the Commonwealth of the Bahamas to wear a different pair of socks. Is that the same organization as a Spectrum organization? Tell me the difference.
Okay, so, and so, you know, children that are, we called disabled or challenged, you know, it's all under an umbrella. And with the, wear the different type of socks that we had last week, that was for children with Down syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, there are some children with Down syndrome that have been affected with autism, but autism spectrum is not grouped with Down syndrome, but they're all developmental disorders. So, yeah, the thing is that, you know, you think that a lot of people are aware of what autism is, and that's not, it's not entirely true. So when a parent comes to the office or to the clinic and they say, you know, doc, I'm a bit concerned. My child is 2, 3, 4 years old, not talking, not pointing, which is a big indicator, not communicating like they should, especially a parent say, well, whenever we call his name, he doesn't answer. Just like Donnell said, that's one of the things that cue a parent right off the bat. And then I have other children and they're just not acting the way my child act at that age. And some parents just shy away and keep them in the closet because they said maybe they're just retarded. You know that word.
Mm-hmm.
And so the education is lacking. The stigma is there too because they're afraid mm-hmm. that they can't do anything about this child. Not correct. You know, so we want people to be aware of the fact that these are the signs and symptoms. And then the key is early intervention is the early intervention.
But
so that's
are the resources,
thing that's stress.
Are the resources here for the early intervention?
So.
Well, my personal experience would have been ABA is scientifically proven to be the most effective form of therapy mm-hmm. for children with autism spectrum disorder, applied behavioral analysis. And then there's the speech and occupational therapies that come, you know, along with it. Having access to those therapies for your child does not come cheaply. They're, you know, an hour for an hour session of just ABA could run you into $60 to $70 an hour. And then a child with autism could require three of those therapies.
Per week?
Per week. In the U.S., it's, from my experience, children usually get 40 hours per week of applied behavioral analysis. That's how intense it has to be. Here in the Bahamas, a parent could barely afford 1 hour a week. If you push it, maybe you might get 3 hours. And that was the situation I found myself in. My son required applied behavior analysis. He required speech and he required occupational. So I found myself having to choose. And after I could no longer choose, that led me to make the move that I did. Because in the schools in the U.S., the children there who are on the spectrum, they are in a special ed environment, but they have speech therapy free, occupational therapy free of charge.
So, Dr. Miller, mm-hmm. Donnell, explain to me, explain to my listening audience, children that are on the spectrum, they're just slightly different from everybody else.
So physically or phenotypically, when you look at this child, they look normal. Mm-hmm. There's no features of autism.
Okay.
So they look like a normal child.
Mm-hmm.
The only problem is social communication and social interaction, and then they have these restricted or repetitive behavioral patterns. So they do things over and over. They behave different. They can't, like you and I are talking, we're communicating back and forth. I'm saying something, you understand what I say, you say it back to me. We're making eye contact. So all of these things are lacking with them. Okay, so they can't make that connection. All right, so this is the problem. Like Donnell said, and so they need behavioral intervention. And research have proven that once they get early intervention, no, it's not a cure, but they can become even almost normal citizen where they can interact in the community, get a job.
But I just want to piggyback off of that for a quick second. You have the celebrities. There are celebrities that we are all familiar with.
That are autistic.
That are autistic, including the now really popular Chris Rock.
Mm-hmm.
He was recently diagnosed as having autism in his adult life.
Mm-hmm.
You have Anthony Hopkins. You have Elon Musk, Bill Gates. They're all somewhere on the spectrum. So I'm wondering if we were to invest in resources for our children here in the Bahamas, what could our children end up being? Our children with autism are very meticulous at the things that they do. We can end up with a individual who finds the cure for cancer, who finds the cure for AIDS. You just never know who's the next innovator for something that is desperately needed in our country.
And as Donnell says, and that's correct. So like a parent asked me yesterday, and that's the misconception. Are they able to learn?
Right.
Are they, again, the word retarded? No, these children are able to learn. They usually have near normal or super normal intelligence. Most of them are above average intelligence.
Right.
For example, my son, and Donnell can tell you with her son, my son started to read from he was 3 years old. These kids, there's nothing wrong with their brain per se in terms of learning. So, like I said, it's a behavioral problem, and the behavioral problem needs to be intervened quickly and corrected. So we need the resources in order to target these children and correct this behavioral problem, because we never know what they're going to end up, what they can contribute to society.
Dr. Miller, you also spoke about a stigma that the children have.
Mm-hmm.
You go to family functions. What happens then? Why I'm asking you these questions is because I want the awareness and the understanding that these are normal children just like everybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody knows where you're going to fall in life.
Mm-hmm.
Anything can happen.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to find out from you, if you're at a function, at a family event, or they just go to a birthday party, whatever it is, how do you communicate, or how do you get people to understand, like, this is not like something that's contagious, and you can reach across the avenue and you can have a conversation, or you can interact with the children because they're children, you know, and it's a behavioral situation,
exactly.
So you don't want people to treat them a specific way. So how do you get people to understand that it is what it is? How do you get them to understand?
So unfortunately, just like you said, that is a problem. So you go to a function and they might have an outburst, which is one of the problems. They might have an outburst, scream, cry. They might do things repetitive. Someone might kind of come up to them and say, oh, hi, how are you doing? And they don't give eye contact, or they don't respond, or they respond by looking away. And people might be offended, and people look at you and gawk or open their eyes, or what happened? This child is rude. Why is this child acting this way?
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, sometimes you even ignore the fact and you may not say what's going on. And a lot of parents do that as well. That's why they keep them hidden away at home.
Right.
Or you try to explain to them and you say, well, you know, they have autism. Oh, what is that? Or, oh, they don't look that way. How does autism look? Like I said, autism doesn't have a face. And so you have to explain to persons what autism is, and to let them know, no, they're not trying to be rude. They're not being rude. This is a behavioral issue. A lot of people think it's something genetic or just something going on in the brain. And they can't help the way they're behaving. And that's one of the reasons why we're trying to get them help.
So, Dr. Miller, Mrs. Miller, Donnell, have you lobbied legislation? Have you lobbied cabinet? How are you getting this word out? How are you making this happen, Mr. Miller?
I think that's one of the most difficult parts. I think as parents, I think the public needs to understand that we as parents, we're in panic mode most of the time.
Why?
The thing that frightens us the most is that we know we have a limited time to live. We don't want to die, leaving our children at the hands of people who are not going to care for them the way we do. I think the average parent who has an autistic child, that's on their mind constantly. If I die now,
What happens?
What's going to happen to my child?
Mm-hmm.
There's no government agency in place to prop them back up. So it's a frantic race. You're racing the clock. This is a clock thing now.
You're running against time.
I'm running against time. Time's running out. They're getting older. If I die now, can they fend for themselves? Can they get a job? Can they function in society? You see, I hear them say, act normal. Autism is a different normal.
Mm-hmm.
To another autistic person, together in their group, they're normal. We're not normal.
Mm-hmm.
Because we care about things, or social cues, and responding to a call. And they prioritize differently. Answering of you calling them is not a priority.
It's not.
No. It's not even on their mind. They're focused on something else. Unless you find a way to get into their little space, what we're trying to do to make them function in society so they can take care of themselves, we're trying to pull them out of their little space so they can function as normal as possible in society, so they can be accepted, so they can have jobs, so they can take care of themselves when we are gone. That's our biggest concern. When we're gone, what is going to happen to our children?
What has the government, prior, current, what has happened?
Honestly?
Yes, sir.
Very little. I think they have good intentions.
Mm-hmm.
I think until it becomes a political issue, whereby they realize that if enough families complain, enough families advocate, that like we estimated, the U.S. average is about 44 in every 100, one in every 44 children. Autistic.
Mm-hmm.
If we take that same and compare them to the population of Bahamas, that means we have at least about close to 8,000 people who are on the spectrum.
But you know, Mr. Miller, in most cases, until it affects my backyard, mm-hmm. I don't care.
Yeah.
No, it's more than that.
It does.
We have
persons in past administrations mm-hmm. and current administrations that have children with autism. They can afford it.
The therapy.
They can fly them out.
And so because they can afford it, their plight is not the same as everybody else's.
It isn't.
They're not feeling the pinch.
Yeah.
To them, it's a pinch. For us, it's a blow in the face. It's a punch in the face that it can knock us out at any time. So you need to understand, when she mentioned it's very expensive, it's even more complicated than that.
Yes.
It takes about $80,000 a year to get the child minimum therapy, which is 24 hours a week.
And so they can pay these persons that may have the same affliction as you do, they can send their child to New Jersey and they can just put them away somewhere and they don't have to deal with it on a regular basis.
But our problem in Bahamas is worse than that.
Yes.
If I were to identify 1,000 children with autism right now and I found $1 billion to take care of them and give them the therapy, there's no one to take care of them.
We don't have the
capacity. There are not enough therapists qualified that can handle it. No one's even thought for tomorrow or the day after.
Right.
To say, let's start educating people mm-hmm. in this in the
let's
needs that need to be met.
To mm-hmm.
See, because what's happening politically, if you say there are 8,000 people affected, that's two constituencies. Centerville has, 3,500? Next one has 4,000. That's the equivalent of two constituencies, political. We need two representatives in the House Assembly that just deals with autism. Because we have enough people who have it to say we qualify to be our own constituency.
Right.
But no one represents us in the House of Parliament.
There's no one that you can appeal to
now? Well, lately, let me give a plug. I met privately with Dr. Michael Dowell. I mm-hmm. spoke to him privately not too long ago. And I get the impression, innate impression, that he really wants to do something. But right now, they're only 6 months old. And he's jumped into a COVID whirlwind.
Mm-hmm.
And that's focus. That's his main focus. He has promised me, we have spoken, that things are going to settle down eventually with the COVID problem. Autism and other disorders that need attention is going to become a priority for him. Now, I know Glenys Hannah-Martin is also needs to be involved. But then again, she inherited an educational system that's just barely limping.
Mm-hmm.
So she's focused on trying to get it back on his feet.
Okay.
But we can put them on notice as soon as a certain amount of time has gone by. We will be kicking in their doors, asking for attention, demanding a response, because we're getting older. Like I said earlier, we can't afford to die and leave our children with nobody to fend for them. There has to be some sort of safety net that the government has to put in place to rescue these children. you don't realize this is almost an epidemic, you know. Mm-hmm. This is just as bad as COVID. This is spreading, and we've seen it happening so rapidly, and nobody's responding. I know REACH is trying with their limited resources, and we thank them for being on the ball for so many years, but they can only reach so much.
Right, and basically our mandate is to aggressively advocate for fair and appropriate, equitable education, health services, so just support.
And you have to understand, like I was telling Donnell, I'm there in the medical field where the parents are coming to me. The parents are crying out. The parents are asking for assistance. And you know, you want to help as much as possible. And when your hands are tied and you feel helpless, you want to do something. And I understand from so many perspectives, a medical point of view, I understand that time is of the essence. And I'm a mom too. I understand what you have to go through when you go home in the afternoons. And you still have to work and you still have to function. So I understand all of these things. And when I diagnose and I can't give you the resources that you need.
Then what?
Yeah. So I feel helpless.
We are going to be back with this conversation. This is Kendini Campbell-Moss, and I'm on Guardian Radio AM 96.9. Fresh News, Smart Talk, all day.
One thing there is no debate about is that PTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your PTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to PTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with PTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a PTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
Five-time defending Carifta Swimming Champions Team Bahamas is headed to Barbados April 16th through 20th for the Carifta Swimming Championships. Show your support for Team Bahamas by placing an ad in the Nassau Guardian Special Carifta Swimming Championship section, which will be published on April 4th. This is your chance to congratulate Team Bahamas, the coaches, or an individual swimmer in their quest for a sixth title. For more information, call your Nassau Guardian account executive now at 302-2300, 302-2300, and get your message in our special Carifta Swimming Championship section. Get ready for the 2022 Carifta Swimming Championships and Team Bahamas going for gold again.
Throughout our lifetime, we must all make decisions. No matter how we choose, the right one just needs to be made. Like having J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers as your insurance partner. We've been serving the Bahamas for over 100 years. Whether you need home, motor, marine, or commercial insurance, make the right decision. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com.
J.S. Johnson Insurance.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
You really try, you'll find there's no need to cry in this place. You feel there's no hurt or sorrow. There are ways to get there. If you care enough for the living, make a little space, make a better place. Heal the world, make it a better place.
strong and only cares for joyful giving. If we try, we shall see in this bliss we cannot feel. There are dreams, stop existing and start living.
Good morning, and I'm back. This is Kendini Campbell-Moas, and we're here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We're speaking this morning about children on the spectrum, and it's a dire need for outreach, for awareness, and for us to stop hiding the children, because it's not that autism happens once a day and it's celebrated once a month. This is a daily situation that these parents live. And we listen to the plight of Mr. Miller and Mrs. Miller and Donnell. And their basic thing is they're running against time. And if something should happen to them right now, God forbid, who is here to step in the gap and to take care of their children and to take care of their children adequately? They don't have millions of dollars to send their child to New Zealand or send their child to New Jersey and put them in a specific situation. But you have persons that are in positions of power that can make things happen. And we must have the fortitude to go ahead and say, listen, autism is a very, very real thing. And if it is captured on the onset, it's a behavioral issue, mm-hmm. and we can work towards getting some reconstruction of this issue. Mm-hmm. As a parent, as we're all parents, we think about what will happen to our children. That is, I think that's every mother's yes. biggest worry. Mm-hmm. What will happen to my children? Mm-hmm. And you can say as much as you like, oh, somebody drops down dead. I can look after little Johnny. I can look after little Susie. After the funeral and everyone have on the big hat, you forget about these people's children mm-hmm. because you have your regular life and that's really not your concern.
And your own children.
You have your own children to be content with. And that's the reality of it.
Yes.
A mother, there's nothing like a mother's love.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Am I right?
Yes. Right.
I want us to be very cognizant of the fact that children with autism or children on the spectrum, they're children too.
Yes.
And we need to work towards the awareness of this particular issue.
Awareness and acceptance.
And acceptance. How what have you put forward that we can try to assist you with here at The Guardian? Is there an article that we could write? Is there a newspaper? What can we do as a community to get this word out more? Any ideas? And just go ahead, Mr. Miller.
Like, I remember the newspapers used to have a weekly or a section. They have the weekend news and they advocate for entertainment and where to go to eat, where to go to have fun. Could there be like a spot in the papers on the weekly that updates families who are dealing with this and say, spot a child and say, this is how the child is improving? Because we're almost like a forgotten group because we're looked at as problems. Nobody wants to hear about our problems because they have enough of their own. I think the spotlight needs to not be once a year in April, but it needs to be a weekly thing that the papers can highlight every week. Like they wait for certain times of the year, every year, annual this, and then they spotlight Down syndrome, they spotlight autism, and then it goes away. Suddenly everybody feels like autism has disappeared. Down syndrome has disappeared.
But it's very prevalent.
Yes.
It doesn't go away. Yeah. This is
because this is what you deal with every single day.
I think if there's a persistent awareness and recognition, then we can take tiny steps towards having something in place where there's a real solution. We have small pockets. There are schools that would house like a special ed unit or an autism unit. We have like Willard Patton, the Early Education Center now is doing it. And props to Willard Patton. There's an autism unit. Awesome. Very awesome.
They can be highlighted
sometimes. Yes, but we need to have more. So even we don't have specialists that probably know how to get these things together, but we need to bring them in. Like, not just April, every month we need to be aware that, guess what, this is the problem. How can we solve this? Let's target this one step at a time where we can actually see results, okay? Where we can see results. We need to see results. And not just where I'm not just here talking for my kids. It's for the community at large, because I'm seeing it constantly, all right? Because they come, they want help. We're evaluating them. Then what do we do?
What then?
What do I do?
Mr. Miller?
My personal view is that I hope for the conversations with government persons.
Right.
I'm going to advocate specifically for one thing, to put therapy under NHI.
And now, then we would need the therapist.
My thing is, I hate to say it about the average person, but they're motivated by greed. Let me explain.
The thing about it is that we sugarcoat everything. Your wife specifically said we put a Band-Aid on things. Maybe if we highlight some things, we wouldn't have to say, I don't mean to say.
Yeah.
You know, maybe we need to say that.
Mm-hmm. Correct. People are motivated by greed. Say if, and you know how the market works, mm-hmm. supply and demand.
Definitely.
If they know that they're going to get paid. See, they're not going to check for people who don't have the money to pay them.
No.
That's why there's no big pool of therapists. Yeah. Because the money's not there. But if the government can somehow put that under the NHI umbrella, then there becomes
a need,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Then the average person who is motivated by greed, there's money to be made.
So let me
they will meet that. They will come up with
they will
supply.
Meet the demand. Mm-hmm.
They'll meet that demand quickly, and they'll send people off to get qualified as ABA specialists, occupational and speech therapists right away, because they realize that if they have 20 people in a facility that can provide these services, they're going to be full 24/7, and they're going to make money.
They will.
People are motivated by money.
Let me get through some of these texts, because our text audience has definitely sent us some messages here. My heart goes out to the autistic children and especially their parents, to that organization that works so hard to deal with their issues and or challenges. I strongly recommend that you all use the channel within the United and other relevant world bodies to put pressure on the Bahamian government to rapidly move to put the vital necessary systems, facilities of education, healthcare, and all the various other support vehicles in place, both in public and private arenas. And also, if they need to import experts from abroad to build manpower, mm-hmm. so be
That's
it.
That's the goal.
Yeah.
Again, I say use the United Nations and other relevant world powers to put pressure on the Bahamian government. This is another text that has come in.
Are they saying we need to use Uncle Sam to beat up our own country to get them to respond?
Essentially, that's what that text is saying.
God forbid.
This next text reads, Hi, Ms. Campbell. I'm proud of your guest, who is a parent and also a teacher. I've seen instances where mothers would beat their children almost to death because they do not consult a doctor and think the child is being rude. We have a caller on the line. Good morning, caller. You're on the line.
Hi, good morning. How are you?
I'm well, ma'am. How are you?
I am good. So I am simply calling in because I'm tuning into the show, and I really want to give my input on, you know, having a child with autism.
Go right ahead, ma'am.
I listen to everything that Donnell and Mr. Miller said. And I can honestly say wholeheartedly that I not only agree with what they say, but my husband and I were living this. Because our son, he was diagnosed at 2.5 with autism. And since then, it's been a whirlwind, because I heard Donnell said earlier, it came a point where she had to choose between the three therapies. And we're actually in that predicament now. And even before we came to this point, our son hadn't had therapy for years because we could not afford it. ABA, almost $72 an hour. Speech. Some persons are $50 who have a heart for you, who, you know, understand your plight. Others are $100 an hour. Occupational, $60 an hour. and they need at least 25 hours of each of these therapies a week. And, you know, government officials, you know, elections just went. And, you know, they made all of these promises and you know, they highlighted certain things that they wanted to, you know, tackle on their mandate. But every single time I see elections or every single time I hear a politician, you know, bring their ideas and everything to the forefront, autism is never on the platform. Special needs is never on the platform. We are families that are struggling. We are struggling. Literally sometimes we have to choose between our child getting therapies and putting food on the table. We are literally drowning. There are no safety nets for us. We haven't seen anything as it relates to, you know, assistance with social services, you know, because, you know, they assist with persons who are unable to, you know, to pay their bills, so on and so forth. But when they look at us, they look at, okay, we have a job and, you know, we're working. As far as they're concerned, because we have a job, we don't need assistance. No one asks us what we're going through because we may have jobs, but none of that accounts for disposable income because everything that we make, we try to put into our kids so that our kids can be independent for when we're not here anymore. Because I could tell you, I know if I'm not here, if I die today or tomorrow, there's no one to help my son. There's nobody. And no one hears our cry. No one understands what we are going through. The only persons who understand what we're going through is each other because we know the plight that we go through every day. So at this point, government has to step in because it's hard. It's really hard. They have preschools. Willard Patton, I must say, is a really good one. But they have other schools. Case in point, I tried to enroll my son in Palmdale Primary so that he can be around neurotypical kids where he can mimic, you know, some of their behaviors along with getting a good education. And when I told, the first thing that came out of their mouth when I told them that he was autistic was the fact that, did you know Garvin Times is specially dedicated for kids with autism, but what no one wants to talk about is when the children are in Garvin Times only has the autistic kids group together. Early Childhood Development Center, the preschool, he was there. They only have autistic kids in that class. They will not learn. They mimic each other's bad behaviors. It took the pandemic to come in 2020 for my son to shed the bad behaviors that he picked up from a class of eight with only autistic kids. They do not learn that way. They have to be surrounded by neurotypical kids in order for them to learn. So I'm really calling for you to hear my frustration, for you to hear that exactly what the Millers and exactly what Darnell is saying. It's not falling on deaf ears, and what they're saying, we're living it. So government has to hear what we are saying.
I appreciate
you, caller. That's all I wanted to say.
Caller, do you know Donnell and Mr. and Mrs. Miller? Can we get your number? Can I send you my... She knows your. She is aware of you. Okay,
yes.
So you know each other. Okay, I just wanted to probably share your contact so that you can have some contact. But I understand what you're saying, and as long as 96.9, as long as Guardian gives me this platform, and as long as Mr. Dwight Strawn sees fit to give me this platform, you have an open door to come and speak about your plight. You have that from me. I want to say that the door is open for you.
Yes, Casey, thank you. I just wanted to plug in there that we have written to several government officials. We have called, we've gone to see, and we are awaiting a response from those persons. We're waiting for just to be able to present the ideas that we do have. We're not just approaching with the attitude to say, do something. We do have ideas. We do have
a plan.
Okay. These are some more tips.
You should also keep in mind we did the same thing with the previous government.
Yes.
Well, this is the time.
I was still waiting.
Well, this is the time now, Mr. Miller, to apply pressure because Dr. Dabal did say this is also wellness.
Yes.
And so with wellness and now having NHI, maybe there's something that can and will be done. And hope springs eternal. We have to be fortified and thinking that something is going to change. These are some more texts that are coming in. I see my phone lines blinking. I wonder, though, is the presence of autism or the probability of the autism heightened in the children, the older children that are older and the parents that have them? I don't think that I read that properly. I'm trying to speed through everything. And then it appears to me that more children are being identified as having autism traits, or do we credit that to more education out there, or are parents stepping forward earlier? This is another text here reading. Casey, I'm so happy that you're having the show today. I like the diversity in your shows. Please give my love and my care to the parents that are in your studio. Do we have time for this call? Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning, Ms. Kennedy Moss.
Good morning, sir.
And your guest. And so I appreciate what they're doing. I don't have an autistic child, but I have two children. And so the lady that called, it moved me because she gave a human story. I thought maybe she should be on the radio at some point in time because she's articulate and she can humanize and really detail what is really going on. Now, some of the texts open up my mind to things I've read years ago. So the fact that this might frighten the status quo, those in the know, right? They don't want to tell you the ideology of association and cause. I wanted to call earlier, right, Ms. Moss, so that you could have given the data to show the increase in autism, right? And as they added more adjuvants to the vaccines, of course they would deny this and they are reaping our minds by controlling and censoring the internet, right? But what I'm saying is, it seems to me as if a lot of children are being born with autism. And so what happens is now, they want to deny this. But I've seen a mother that abused drugs. I've seen a father that abused alcohol, and their children came out autistic. These ladies are not that type of character. So the fact that you're seeing a deviance in autism, it shows that there is an association and a cause. So what I wanted you to do for me, the next time we discuss this, go online and pull the data to show that the increase in vaccinations is association with this. Now, they denied the doctor called them all this and that, but what I'm saying is, just look at the data.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. This has been Kendini Campbell Moss, and our conversation today with Children on the Spectrum. I want to thank Mr. and Mrs. Miller and Donnell for coming in and speaking with us today. We have opened the door so that they're able to come back and make sure that there's awareness, acceptance, and some proactive action that takes place in our society. This has been an eye-opening experience for me today, and I thank you for coming in, and I thank you for your honesty and your bravery. This is Kendini Campbell Moss, and this is Guardian Radio 96.9. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I never found anyone who fulfilled my needs. A lonely place to be, and so I learned to depend.